All right, so before I start, I'd like to take a little poll on who actually works in IT. Who gets a paycheck for being in IT? Okay, good. Okay, so my name is Rene Ramirez, and I am an IT guy. The reason I'm up here today is because all my life, everybody has always asked, you know, the question of what do you do for a living? And I say I'm an IT guy, and automatically people think that maybe I'm with a screwdriver all day fixing hard drives or something. But on my first slide, it says cell phones off, but it's really not that. What I want you all to do is turn on your cell phones. Turn on the sound, because as we go through it, I like to hear the sounds. I want to hear what you all have. If you all have an Android or an iPhone, just kind of polling, turn them on. Just when it starts to ring, though, stop it. It'll keep us awake, I promise. Okay, so when I started going into IT, it was the mid-80s, probably aging myself, but I was a little kid. The resources really weren't there. There was no Google, there was no W3 schools, there was nothing like that. My first computer was an IBM PC Junior with 64K RAM. It was horrible, but it was color and I was happy. Later on, in the late 80s, I moved to a Macintosh LC, and so then I fell in love with Macs and left the Windows world, or the DOS world at the time. And then now, obviously, we're in a different age of different machines. But I've been doing this for a long time, and I've seen a lot of things progress. I'm from here, and there's lots of things that have changed here locally. Lots of technology that's come in. I was actually at the Chase Building, which used to be McAllen State Bank, if anybody remembers that. And that's pretty much where a lot of the hub of technology came out in the mid 90s, and probably still one of our most technological buildings in town, in McAllen anyway. So it's just kind of a little background on how long I've been doing this. This is kind of my little resume. I graduated from Baylor. I'm from McAllen. I graduated from Mac High. I double majored when I was in college. I've got a finance degree and an MIS degree. If anybody doesn't know what MIS is, it's Management Information Science. It's the business side of computer science degrees. These slides, I usually do them for students. I go to students and talk to them, and a lot of them ask me what type of majors they need to have when they go to school. And so I just kind of put that. Right now, I have two jobs, basically. I work for a company in town that I'm the IT director, network admin, you name it. I do it. We look over technology investments. We look over I'm in charge of the servers, the software, everything there. I also have an IT support company. We have some licensed software out there that people rent from us and lease from us and use on a regular basis. We have support desk guys that run around town doing stuff. So that's what I do. So here's my disclaimer. I'm about to go through basically five different functions of what IT career paths are, and this is my general take on it. There are specialists in all of these categories. A lot of the jobs overlap, and so sometimes if you're a software guy, you got to know servers and stuff like that. I know that, but I've just kind of categorized a lot of the stuff into five different topics just for talking purposes. All right, so the five different types of IT career paths, the first one is help desk guys. These are the guys that when you pick up the phone and your printer's broken, you've got a blue screen of death, you got a virus, these are the guys that go around and fix those little issues that you have with your machines. They're usually the front of a lot of places, and they're the ones that, you know, get a lot of yelling and screaming a lot of times. But, you know, in talking about help desk, you need to be, you have to have a good OS understanding. So in each one of these career paths, I'm going to just kind of tell you what kind of personalities you got to have and what kind of skill sets you have to have. You have to have a good OS understanding. You got to know your Windows pretty good. You got to know your machines pretty good. You got to know some hardware pretty good. You got to have good customer service skills because people are going to, you know, be confused. People are going to be upset. And then generally they're just calling you for help and they don't know what they're doing. And then you have to have good speaking skills. You have to talk clearly, slowly, and not talk down to people. I mean, that's a really bad situation whenever you have your help desk guys talking down to people because they don't know how to run a machine. The next one is networking. These are your generally your network admins. These guys are in charge of communication between the machines, in charge of the servers. They manage the networks for the people. They have you have to have some really good vendor relationships with people. That you got to know Cisco. You can have some other certifications. You got to know your Wi-Fi. These are the guys when the internet goes down or the server's down or something like that. These are the guys you call, and you really call the help desk, and the help desk will then basically say, "All right, I got to get the network guys to look at this stuff." For this, you kind of have to have a decent knowledge of help desk stuff. You got to know a little bit about what's going on at the desktop to make sure that it's not the desktop and it's actually the network that's doing something weird. You have to have good, strong relationships with resources. I think that a good network admin has good resources. They know, you know, they don't have to know everything, but they need to know somebody that could help them, you know. You can't know everything, and if you've got a Cisco, you know, router that goes down and you don't know Cisco, you gotta know a Cisco guy. If your VMware stuff goes down, you gotta know where your VMware guy is. Another one is you have to also have good customer service, and then you have to be able to self-manage. You're going to be in a little room somewhere with servers, and you know you just can't wander off, and you got to be able to be able to say, look, I got to get this done all the time, and you know when to balance that time of when things get done. Now it looks like my slides are out of order. But I don't know where that one slide is, but the next one that I was going to go through is software programming. Programming, you know, this is another career path totally different from network admins and help desk. It's programming, this is your apps guys, these are your web designers, these are the guys that are writing code all day, and basically sitting there behind the machine. These guys are very different than network admin guys. They're just dealing with code. And realistically, you know, all the coders that I've ever met, you know, they really don't have the social skills to be out in front of people, talking to people. So usually you have to have some intermediary between them. Next one on the list is project management. Project management is pretty much keeping people on task. You have certain things that happen in the IT world, like software development or rollouts of equipment and stuff like that. You need to have somebody at the very beginning that is going to say, hey, these are the goals, these are the points that we need to meet and when they need to meet. You've got to have good management skills to do that. You've got to be able to have a few different things up your sleeve, like maybe Scrum or some type of agile. Agile training or something to that effect. But another thing is that you got to have good industry knowledge. If you don't know anything, if you're at a hospital doing a software implementation and you never know, you don't know medical terms or stuff like that, you better get up to speed on it. If not, your whole project's going to go get delayed.
some people ask me what type of certifications they need to have for this type of stuff to really excel and look marketable to your employers. One of them is PMP stuff. PMP is very difficult here in town to do. There's not a lot of certified projects to get done, but I've seen a few city bids and stuff like that that require PMP stuff. If you can get it, get it. ITIL certification. That's another one that's that's kind of a project-based certification. It's also becoming very popular to do that. You got to know a little bit of code, just be able to read it, understand it sometimes, depending on your project. If you don't know any of the base stuff that you're working on, you're not going to know what type of team to put together. That's a real key point in project management, is getting the right team together. If you need coders, you got to know what type of coders you're going to get. If you need to get networking people involved, you got to know which networking guys to get, and that suits the project the best. Consulting, sales. That's usually the next one on the line. Those guys are usually salespeople because they're usually going into a business, knocking on the doors, and saying, hey, you need my product, and this is how it best works for your company. You have to have good industry knowledge for that also. I mean, that's one of those things. I hear people say right out of college that, hey, I'm a consultant, but really, they've never really worked in an industry or they're not specialized in some industry, and it doesn't go well. But they have to have good writing and communication skills. Usually, the consulting guys will also, once they've made a sale, they will then employ the project managers. The project managers then get the programmers, the programmers, and then also the network guys or whatever it is for the project that they've sold. They pretty much kind of, you know, if it's compartmentalized, they'll send it off to the project manager once they've made a sale and said, hey, you know, these guys, they expect it to get done. And, they're usually the money guys. They figure out, you know, how much money to charge and all of that stuff. Next on my list, I can't believe no phones have gone off. I haven't heard a text message or ring, nothing.
That's all I have here.
Really? I haven't heard it up here. Maybe I'm too loud for myself. All right, this is the end of my presentation. I know it's kind of short, but I think that one of the reasons I told you was already why I was up here is because I'm an IT guy, and nobody knows what I do. But I do pretty much. From the bottom up of that list that I was showing, I do consulting, I do project management, network stuff. I don't do a lot of code. I just can't, I don't have the time for it. But one of the things that I talk about is that the reason I did this is not to push you to go towards IT. This is not the purpose of that. Obviously, if you want to go to IT, go for it. You know, that's a good industry to be in. But if you're a manager in an organization, or if you're a business owner, you need to know that if you're working with somebody to get a project done, that these are the team members that you need to have on that project. You know, also if you're working with some company and there's a few IT guys in another room and you just don't know what that department does, that's the purpose of this, to know what they're doing over there in the other room with all those servers and stuff. There's a lot more to it than just fixing a computer. That's kind of the very basics of it. There we go. Apple phone?
Yeah.
How many Androids?
Androids?
Wow, that's a lot. How about Apple?
How about Apples? Yeah.
So anyway, it's just kind of a presentation to know what your peers are doing.
The Kerr phone.
Ben Gay here. But anyway, that concludes my presentation. Thanks for being sports on the phones. But I didn't have as much fun as I usually do with them. I didn't hear them. Thanks, guys. Any questions?
Can I have you? I've worked in technology, can you expand on the importance of business ethics in technology? That's something that I struggle with some of my young employees, and how important that is. It's very important.
In what sense? I mean, are you talking about piracy, or are you talking about like hacking, or?
I'm talking about anything. illegal use of customer information, anything that's unethical, because you have access to that information.
So part of being an IT person and getting in charge of a lot of data is that there's some people that entrust you with a lot of money, basically. I know people's passwords, I know people's bank accounts, I know people's accounting data, all sorts of stuff. The way that I always looked at it is that I'm in it for the long term. I'm in it for the career. And if I learn somebody's information and I start giving it out, and my career is done, nobody's gonna hire me anywhere. And trust is one of those big deals in IT. Is that no job, and it's something I love.
People need to hear that. Yes, I've had to fire many people over the years because of that.
Yeah.
One mistake, you'll lose your job just like that. It's
your job. It's your career. And if you're committed, if you've got a degree in it, and you're in it for the career-wise, you don't want to ruin it. I mean, it's just like being like a policeman and getting busted for something. I mean, that's your career is done.
Due to my lack of knowledge of coding, I might be phrasing your question wrong, but. What would you say are some of the most maybe longer lasting or practical coding languages to learn these days?
Well, that's a tough one, but if you know C, C is pretty much a base language for a lot of stuff. And so if you start getting some of the fundamental languages, then you can branch off and learn those a lot quicker. I mean, that's pretty much a big one. If anybody else can answer that, that's a better coder than me.
I can answer that a bit. So essentially with programming languages, they fall under a paradigm of how that language works. What you want to do is that you want to learn how each paradigm works, or pick a few popular ones. Right now there's a big trend for object-oriented languages, such as Java, C++, such and such. If you just want to language right now, Java, C++, Python, and maybe some web design languages, then you'd be fine. But for the long lasting, you want to learn the paradigms. If you know the paradigms and how the structure of a language works, picking up a new language will be done in a few days.
I also don't consider electrical engineers in IT, even though they use code. Yeah, I know. You and I have had this conversation, but graphics guys that do animation, I don't consider that an IT career either. But they're good careers, but they're not IT.
Small business owner, how do we go about hiring the right IT person, the right IT company? How do we know we're paying for what we're getting? Since if I'm not a technology guy or anything, what can we do?
That's tough. Check your references. Check the references pretty good. They got, I always push for education. I usually have this kind of talk with some high school students and stuff and say, go to college. and usually, to me, those are good indicators of somebody. Experience, the references and experience is a big deal. Making sure that they haven't gotten fired from somewhere for stealing data. I mean, those are usually your indicators?
When you interview, you have to get people to do actual work, write a piece of code, because you get so much bullshit If you're not believing people come to interviews, they can't write a line of code.
Right.
Are there good questions that you can ask these IT people to find out if they're really knowledgeable? Is there like a
Well, that's difficult, because if you're talking about an employer that knows nothing about technology, you know, there are some companies out there that, if depending on your budget of hiring, you can send them through testing basically and see what they know. That's something that you see at places like USAA and some of the bigger companies that hire mass amounts of technology people. They do hire some type of third party to test them and make sure that they know what they're talking about.
Yeah, but most places don't get that either. If you're a small company and you only want one or two people, you want to get one person who can do everything, not one of the drones of those places hire them.
Yeah. 15. Yeah, and you know, I was saying that I can do pretty much everything on the board, but like programming, I'm very little. I can read it, but I can't do it. I have to do everything, and that's one of those things that comes with experience and just knowledge of you know what you're doing.
And how's the market right now for IT opportunities? I guess, like, if you're an IT consulting firm, or like a, you know, consulting or whatever, that you're an IT firm, is the market like flourishing in the valley, or
well? You know, it's kind of hit or miss sometimes, but in a general sense, what I have seen is that 10 years ago, the market was not great for IT people. It kind of has gone in waves. Right now, I think that we're in an uptick. The people that my peers that I know are getting hired for more money than they would have been 5 years ago. It goes in waves. I think it has something to do with the economy. It basically, you know, some IT people are, you know, it's a luxury, I guess. But, you know, that's really not true. but I think that as specializations happen, that also goes up in money. And the market's decent right now for it. It just kind of depends on what your skill set is. Any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
Now, one thing that I've seen real popular with employers is that they like to find somebody that's a jack of all trades, or IT guy,
right?
As you say. What would you recommend to do in a push to show people that hiring specialized people rather than a jack of all trades, that's a general IT guy?
Well, it all depends on the company. I mean, if it's a, you know, people always have asked me in the past of at what point do we have to hire an IT guy in the company? And, you know, it depends on the type of company, but I always start to say around 30 people. Yeah, you start to have somebody in-house that's kind of a generalist that knows a lot of stuff. But then, you know, as a generalist sometimes they just need a database guy or they just need a coding guy in there. That will be your job to kind of educate the people that you're working for that, hey, I'm the network admin, but I need these people, or we need to start hiring out and start to analyze whether or not the money is worth to keeping it out of house or not. I mean, I think it comes down to economics on that. Yeah.
And dependency on technology.
Yeah, I mean, if you got 30 guys building a house, I mean, you don't need an IT guy, you know. But, you know.
If you got 5 employees, but you got a supercomputer and 37 printers and, you know, T1 lines out the wazoo, you need a tech guy.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you got to really analyze how much money you're spending.
Yeah.
You had a couple of questions?
So, I mean, I have no idea.
So if you're an IT and you want to be an IT guy at a hospital, you have to have some industry knowledge. I mean, that's a very good example of you know, somebody who can't just transfer one way over. I mean, with training, yes, but you know, in those career paths, a lot of them are not management positions. You know, programming is not management, and you know, you don't need to have a terrible amount of industry knowledge whenever you do that. But that's a specialized career path. That if I just want to be a programmer, you know, you don't have to be an entrepreneur to do that. You don't have to have the personality to stand in front of a bunch of people and make a sale. That's somebody else's job, and it's still a very good job. Anybody else? Yeah.
Do you have a dedicated project manager on your
team? I am.
I was going to ask, what's the organizational structure of what you put together?
Well, it's a little bit different because the development that we do or the projects that we do, a lot of it is hired out. As a project manager, I don't have the resources to hire somebody to be on staff just doing that all the time. So, you know, I'm working on a very large software rollout, and it's just kind of my job to make sure that I'm a little bit of a liaison between the company and the software company. And the software company has to put together their own project management timeline because they know their software better. And so a lot of my job is to kind of interpret what the customer needs to what is being sold. I mean, that's a huge one for me.
I guess how many of your customers have their own IT guy?
Well, very few, because then it wouldn't be my customer.
Use you as a mediator between what?
Very little. I've got a guy here that worked for me before, and he knows that. We've had to work with IT people before. Unfortunately, one of the things that we run into a lot in the Valley is this competitive attitude that I'm not going to show you what I have, or I know more than you, or something to that effect, and that's a really bad situation, because collaboration really does work, and transfer of knowledge really does work. So very seldom does a local IT people let other IT people in the door here, anyway.
Yeah. So I just got back from Boston. I was doing basically help desk, maybe some small bits of coding stuff up there, and you just go on Craigslist and you find IT jobs. Where is the best place to work in the Valley?
A lot of people that I know go into IT at municipalities, cities, hospitals, large government type jobs. That works well. Banks. The bigger places that have a lot of employees, that's where you're going to get a job entry level that's decent, and you're not going to be expected to know everything when you walk in the door. I mean, that's my opinion. I don't know if anybody else has an opinion on that. Yep. Thanks.